small things here and there. These do happen in a conference of this magnitude. Today I'll be talking on transperaminal endoscopic discectomy or transperaminal endoscopic spine surgery, known by many names. Now, if you look at discal-related problems, what options do we have in pain medicine? Apart from intradiscal steroids or maybe ozone or maybe some radiofrequency procedures and some percutaneous discectomy procedures like the Stryker decompressors and nucleotomes, there is nothing much that we can offer. Second thing is, what we are interested in the disc is just not a discectomy or to pressurize the disc, but what we need in the disc is a targeted fragmentectomy. We have to understand a single philosophy that until and unless you have an annular tear with a degenerated nucleus underneath the annular tear, there cannot be back pain and there cannot be leg pain. Nucleus by itself is a proteoglycan, so antigenic to the nervous tissue, and so this has to be basically prevented. So it's the annular tear and a degenerated disc under the annular tear which is the entire crux of the problem. Decompressing this disc from the center of the disc is not going to serve the purpose, because there is no pathology in the center of the disc. The pathology is located in the posterior part of the disc, which we need to target. Okay, so what are the options that we've got? Basically, we have two options to treat this kind of a problem. One option is to do a blind procedure like a manual discectomy and a thermal annuloplasty using the 4.1 MHz radio frequency, which is called as a disc-fix system. And the second option is a visualized discectomy and all the options for annuloplasty and repairing and all these things, which is transperaminal endoscopic discectomy or transperaminal endoscopic spine surgery, known by many names. Now, endoscopic discectomy is not something which has just come up and we have picked it up and we are the pioneers or something like that. No, it's been there in the market since 1977. So it's quite some time back now, people have been using these techniques. Over a period of time, with advancing experience, methodology, technology, we have been able to develop better instrumentation systems, and that is the reason we are now precisely able to target the pathology in a very nice way and treat it effectively. So it started all from 1977 when Hijikata first did a manual percutaneous discectomy. This was non-selective. So he first devised a cannula which can go inside the disc and then you can do a discectomy without visualizing it. So non-selective discectomy. But I think that was the first thing that provoked everybody. Yes, this access through the skin, I mean through the foramen, is possible to do a discectomy. Later on, as time progressed, by 1983 was Campbell who first devised did the first non-visualized posterior percutaneous discectomy. Later on it was Asher percutaneous laser discectomy. Now people have been using various kinds of energy sources. The energy sources can be manual energy to remove the disc. It can be the laser energy to ablate the disc. It can be the radio frequency, again a cutting tool and an energy to remove the disc. So does not, it is basically these three different kinds of energies that are used to remove the disc. So it does not matter whether you really do it with the laser, with the radio frequency or a manual discectomy or a shaver, whatever it is. Thing is that your discectomy has to be targeted underneath the pathology or wherever the pathology is, posterior to the disc, not in the center of the disc. So it was in 1991 that Campbell first described the triangular zone. Now this triangular zone between the traversing, it's called as an axilla, between the traversing root and the exiting root and the vertebral end plates, this is a triangle which he called it as a safe triangle. Now as far as the pain thing is concerned, we are also taught about a safe triangle which is the above the nerve, which is a subpedicular triangle. Okay, that's also called as a safe triangle. Now we really have to think, is the subpedicular triangle a really safe triangle? If you go into the anatomy of it, it is definitely not a safe triangle. But the triangle described by Purvis Campbell is definitely a safe triangle, wherein majority of the procedures can be performed. So as far as blocks are concerned, we no more use a subpedicular approach, but we use the Campbell's approach. See, the basic idea between, I'm a little bit over the block. Since we have some time, I can discuss. Okay. the little bit of the block. If you are talking, there are two kinds of blocks that we are talking about. One is a selective nerve root block, SNRB, and second is a lateral recess block. Okay. Now the major difference between these two blocks are, selective nerve root block is an extraforaminal block. You are blocking the root outside the foramen. Lateral recess block is, you are blocking the traversing and the exiting root. More than that, the pathology which is lying there in the paracentral zone at the level of the disc in the lateral canal, where majority of our herniations are. So these are, it's an intraforaminal block. So these are two different things. Suppose you do a selective nerve root block at L4. Okay, so you are doing it at L4-5, so you are blocking the exiting root L4 at L4-5. Patient's pain is gone. Now tell me, which level of the spine is involved? Is it 3-4, where 4 is involved as a traversing root, or is it 4-5, where 4 is involved as an exiting root? Where is the pathology? You still are in a confusion, because a single nerve can be responsive, can have a pathology at two different levels, and the dermatomal distribution could be L4. So if you have a L3-4 with a L4 involved as a traversing root, you're going to have the L4 symptoms again. If you have the L4-5, where L4 is involved as an exiting root, you're going to have the same symptoms. So understanding the dermatome is of no use to me, because I cannot do a procedure after that. What I need to know, what is the level? Where do I go and treat it? So, basic difference is, one is an extraforaminal block and one second is an intraforaminal block. What we call it as a lateral recess block, or the LRB. Okay. So, Campbell described this triangle, which was a very safe triangle. Later on, a lot of studies, anthropometric studies were done. And it was Kuswich who told us that the space is so big enough that it can accommodate a cannula size of 1 centimeter in a Caucasian population. So 1 centimeter of cannula can be accommodated in a European population. Whereas in Indian population, anywhere around 8.5 is the best place where you can put in your cannula. Later on, as time progressed, this visualized discectomy was a very funny thing which Campbell did, but he was limited with the technology that was present at that time. So he used to put first put the scope inside, he used to see, remember what he's saying, take out the scope, put his instrument, and then try to remove it. Understand how difficult it was for him. It was not until 1997 when Dr. Anthony Young from Desert Institute of Spine Care, Phoenix, Arizona, first devised the rigid rod-length scope with an integrated working channel and an irrigation port. This was developed in association with Richard Wolf, Mittlingen, Germany. And this was the first FDA approved scope, and the procedure was also FDA approved by 1991. So this was the first thing where you could see and you could do. This was a 2.7 millimeter working channel scope with two irrigation ports, and it could accommodate instruments of 2.5 and 2 millimeters. As days progressed ahead, we wanted the channels to be bigger so that we can use bigger instrument, we can use more technology like various kinds of shavers and burrs. So it was Sebastian Rutten and Martin Kampf from St. Anna's Hospital, Germany, which they developed two different systems. One was a 3.1 millimeter working channel system, and second was a 4.1 millimeter working channel system. So this could accommodate larger instruments of 3 millimeter and 3.5 and 4 millimeter instruments, which were easy for us to work with now. So we could deal with a lot of bone related issues like stenosis, osteophytes, calcification of the disc, migrated fragments. Everything could be handled in a much, much more better way. I'm fortunate enough to have been trained with Dr. Tony Young in Phoenix, Arizona, and with Martin Kampf and Sebastian Rutten in Germany both. So I know them very well and how they have gone through their learning curve and development. Now if you look at the disc herniation per se, this is a very beautiful diagram, which is most of their slides. You can see that this diagram is there. Disc degeneration, prolapse, extrusion, sequestration. Now as an endoscopic spine surgeon, does this really does it tell me something? See, why do we have a classification system? We have a classification system so that we can devise our treatment plan. That is the necessity of a classification system. But what is the use of a classification system if it is just a classification and does not give me any information as far as how the treatment methodology has to be evolved, or how do I plan my surgery? As an endoscopic spine surgeon, I basically classify herniations to only two types. It's a subligamentous herniation and a transligamentous herniation. What is subligamentous herniation? Any herniation where the PLL, the posterior longitudinal ligament, is intact is a subligamentous herniation, because I know that the epidural space is not involved. Okay, there is nothing in the epidural space. Though patient may have a little bit of sciatica, but predominantly black pain and a little bit of leg pain is a subligamentous herniation. My job is going to be working. My job is going to be working in the disc and taking off the herniation. I have no business in the epidural space. So I don't have to get into the epidural space. Now, getting into the epidural space has to be avoided as far as possible, because we know that's a critical area. We know there is a lot of fat. So when you put in your instruments there, you're going to take off some amount of fat and initiate fibrosis, which we really don't want. Though ventral epidural space is the one where not much fibrosis occurs. Dorsal epidural space is the area where majority of the fibrosis occurs. But still, you don't want to take a chance, or you don't want to burn the bridges for further things. So you really don't want to get into the epidural space. But if you have a transligamentous herniation where the PLL is completely gone and the patient has predominantly leg pain and less of back pain, then your job is not only going to be in the disc, but you also have to work in the epidural space. So you need, if a classification system tells me my plan, I would accept that classification system rather than going ahead and talking about disc degeneration, prolapse, extrusion, sequestration. It doesn't make any sense to me. Okay? Is that clear? Okay. The next one is various kinds of herniation we look at. We look at a central herniation, a paracentral herniation, which could be up-migrated or down-migrated. Could be a foraminal herniation and an extra-foraminal herniation. These are predominant varieties of herniations that we see in our day-to-day practice. Now, some time back, people told, you can operate with endoscope only herniations at the level of the disc. It's no more true. With having better tools now, like shavers and burrs, various kinds of guided burrs, the laser, a good radio frequency, you can still deal with herniations which are up-migrated or down-migrated, whatever level it is, either be calcified or non-calcified. So most of these herniations can be handled comfortably. So if you, preoperative planning is of utmost importance in endoscopy. So if you are targeting an inferiorly migrated fragment, your needle has to approach that fragment so that it becomes easier for you to fish out the fragment and get it out. So how do you preoperatively plan? Your preoperative plan depends upon the MRI and the X-rays. Standard X-rays of AP lateral, lateral inflection and lateral extension are basically required to know that whether there is already an existing instability at that level. Now, instability for many people means fix it, hardware. As an endoscopic surgeon, spine is not a static structure, spine is a dynamic structure. So moving spine should never pain. If a moving spine is paining, there is a pain generator. The pain generator could be a nerve which is adhered to the annulus, a nerve which is adhered to the facet capsule, could be adhered to the ligamentum flavum, or there could be an osteophyte which is tethering, or there could be a facet arthropathy. There has to be something there which is causing the problem. So if we can identify this pain generator without fusing the spine, by keeping its movements intact, we can still treat this patient. So for me, a gross instability wherein you have a lot of movement in the vertebra means that is going to be the place where I would advise a patient of fixation. But in most of the cases, I would say I could treat it endoscopic if I can identify your pain generator. Now, how do I identify this pain generator? You identify this pain generator by using various kinds of blocks, like lateral recess blocks. We use discography as a beautiful tool, and the third thing that we use is spinal probing. So under awake and aware state, you put a small cannula inside and a blunt probe, try touching all the paraspinal muscles, the lateral wall of the facet, the ventral wall of the facet, the interval between the facet and the annulus itself, and sometimes the exiting root. All these can be pain generators, and it can tell you about the concordance of pain. Now, concordance of pain, we are not interested in the dermatomal pattern, but we are interested in the zone. So zone 1 is back, zone 2 is back buttock thigh, zone 3 is back buttock thigh leg. So you are interested, if I probe, the patient initially tells me, okay, my pain is in the zone 3. So you know the pain is in the zone 3. When you probe it and says, my pain is going in the leg, you know it is in the zone 3, it's concordant pain. So you don't have to, oh, you had pain on the lateral aspect of the leg, now do you have it? See, it is so confusing for the patient to understand that really whether it is concordant or not. So classifying these into zones makes us things easy, and the use of the flexion extension x-rays also. So as far as the preoperative planning is concerned, you do take a sagittal section of the T2 weighted image of the MRI and axial section. Draw a couple of lines to understand where, which quadrant the herniation lies. So once you have understood where the herniation is lying, you have to transfer this image theoretically on the image intensive or the x-ray, which is going to be your guide during an intraoperative guidance. So place the fragment or understand where the fragment is located, and once you have made up the idea, the fragment is located in such and such a zone, that is going to be the target where you are going to go and work. So once you have understood that, now you can plan it on the patient, whether it is an inferiorly magnetic fragment, whether it is in the paracentral zone, foramen zone, central zone, where it is located. Depending upon that, you target your needle, and then followed by the needle, the guide wire, the dilators, and so forth, so on and so forth. So let's go into a little bit of an anatomy. This is the slide which I have borrowed from Dr. Tony Young, Anthony Young. This is one of the dissections that we did. So you can see there's ample amount of space. You see the needle that we have placed, that's the level of the disc. You have the exiting root, and it has sufficient space to accommodate a cannula size of 1 centimeter. This is one of the dissections which myself and Dr. Sunil Vagmare did some time back. And you can see that I have removed the facet for better understanding. This part which you see here is the thecal sac, because the spinal cord ends at the lower border of the L1. So this is around L4, 5 or something like that. So this is the thecal sac. This is the traversing root, because it's going to exit at the next level, not at this level. So it's a traversing root. This is the exiting root, which is exiting subpedicular underneath. So the root is labeled as per the vertebral pedicle. If it is an L4 pedicle, it's the L4 exiting root. Okay, so don't confuse with that. So L4, 5, the root is going to be L4, which is exiting, L5, which is traversing. This is the exited root, which has exited a level above. The L3 root, yes. That will form the sciatic plexus there. This is the Cambin's triangle. Okay. Now, the best place to place the cannula here in the Cambin's triangle would be, if you can see the pointer, will be placing the cannula here. Okay. So, the medial most part where I can dock my cannula on the annulus will be the medial pedicular border. Because after the medial pedicular border will be beginning of the spinal canal. So my maximum or the limit to be medial will be the medial pedicular border on the AP, and then I can get it more comfortable, a little bit inferior, so that I can place a big cannula, not laterally. Laterally I don't have any place here. If I try to put a large cannula here, I may jeopardize the integrity of the exiting root. So I have to be careful by putting it right at the point. So the medial pedicular border is the one which we usually use as a guidance for putting in the cannula. So what are the indications for endoscopic surgery? So ideal indications would be an extraforaminal herniation. If you're a surgeon, you know how difficult it is to take off an extraforaminal herniation. Many a times you have to take off the facet to just access the fragment, take it off, and you develop an iatrogenic instability for which you will need a fixation. So that's one thing. Second thing, getting in extra-articular, again, quite a bloody surgery. Anatomy is very obscure, and sometimes unwanted complications can occur in this area. As far as an endoscopic spine surgeon is concerned, the extraforaminal herniation for me is one of the most easiest herniations, because I still don't have to get into the desk. The only thing that I have to do is identify the exiting root, then go and decompressing it. That's the end of it. So I have just turned myself 360s around the cannula, and I'm there on the money. The second is upper lumbar herniations. Large herniation at D12 L1 or L1 L2. Just imagine an orthopedic surgeon or a neurosurgeon taking it off. He does a nice laminectomy. The T thecal sac or the cord is full, it's tight inside, retracting the cord itself with a big herniation underneath it. Just imagine how difficult it's going to be. He may himself cause a lot of problems by doing so. But as an endoscopic surgeon, I get inside underneath the cord or the thecal sac. I can plug out, take it off, complete in toto, exposing or decompressing the entire ventral epidural space. So that's the best thing. Discitis, what options do we have? Bed rest, anti-inflammatory analgesics and IV antibiotics. Does it really help? How many cultures have come positive till date? None of them, because we really don't know our discitis are septic or aseptic discitis, because aseptic discitis is also quite well known. So discitis, the best thing is to get in to into your disc space, deprive your disc space very nicely. Usually you will find a lot of granulation tissue. If it's an old case, you will find sequestra, bone formation which is there lying loose. You deprive everything, wash it out with 3 liters of antibiotic impregnated saline, and then you are done with it. 70 to 80% of the pain is immediately gone after the surgical procedure itself, and then giving in prophylactic antibiotics or anticox, whatever you want to, over a period of time will definitely help. So it makes the patient more comfortable and acceptable so that he can be up and about. Now if you are able to detect discitis at an early age, because of early symptoms are picked up and you diagnose it, the earlier you do a disc debridement, the better chance that you can preserve the disc height. Now why? The disc height is not maintained by annulus, it is not maintained by the nucleus, but it is maintained by the annulus. Primarily when you have a discitis, it is the nucleus which is involved. Later on the annulus gets liquefied, thinned out, and it loses its integrity. So before the annulus gets involved, if you can take care of the disc itself, the nucleus pulposus itself, you have a very good chance that you can still maintain a very good disc height. Recurrent disc herniations, going through the same posterior approach, so difficult it is because everything is stuck up. For a transforaminal surgery, every time it's going to be a virgin area. So not a problem, n number of times. Recurrent herniation does not depend upon the type of the surgery. Whether you do a microscopic surgery, whether you do an open surgery, a posterior interlaminar endoscopy, transforaminal endoscopy, whatever sort of surgery you do, if a recurrent herniation is going to occur, it's going to occur. It is not dependent upon the type of the surgery. But the way you treat it again is really going to matter as far as the surgeon is concerned. Because for an endoscopic surgeon, it is going to be the same area going there, getting the herniation out. There's no problem for him. But for a surgeon who is going posterior, where already one surgery has been performed, it's going to be an extremely difficult task. And that is the place where he's going to have a lot of complications like dural tears and adhesions and all those things. Large sequestrate or herniated disc can now be removed. Discogenic pain. How many options do we have for discogenic pain apart from ozone and bioarcuplasty and all these things? It really doesn't work because it's non-selective. For discogenic pain, now what do you have? We call it as an IDD, internal disc disruption. You have an annular tear, three kinds of annular tears basically. Central annular, which is a radial annular tear, a circumferential annular tears, and a rim lesions. These are the three basic types of annular.